Stop making AI ads until you understand this one thing. And that one thing is product consistency, and nobody's teaching it the right way. This entire ad, every product shot, every action sequence, every scene is all AI generated. But most importantly, our product is consistent across every single frame. And in today's video, I'm gonna show you exactly how to recreate that. And at the end, I'll even show you how to do this automatically using tools like InVideo's MoneyShot. So you wanna create a cinematic AI ad that's showcasing some sort of product. We obviously need product consistency. We're gonna need scene consistency. And most likely we even need character consistency. How can we do all of that? Well, the way we're gonna do that today is by using a five-step framework that is A, very repeatable, and B, extremely flexible, because we can apply this framework to really any sort of AI video generation in general. And the framework looks like this. Step one is gonna be storyboarding, and that's what we see right here. Storyboarding is where we go back and forth with AI and we actually figure out what the heck we're trying to create, and we break it down into discrete scenes. Then we move on to step two, which is the foundation image. For an ad that is showcasing a product, this is where we create that product that's gonna be showcased throughout the video. Next is step three, which is where we create the first frames. This is where we take that foundation image, right? The image of our product, and we now go scene by scene and we create an image that corresponds to the starting image for each of those scenes. This is one of the most important steps because this is where we ensure we have character and product consistency throughout every single scene. Next is step four, which is video creation. So we take the starting images we created in step three, we throw them into a video generator and we actually create the videos. And last is step five, which is production. So we take everything we've created, we throw it into our video editor and we actually create our final product. So that's the framework we're gonna cover today. And let's start with storyboarding. So step one, storyboarding. What is the goal here? The goal is to come out of this with a clear vision of what you're trying to create and the exact scenes that are gonna make up the end video. Now, this is not gonna be a one-shot thing with AI. It's gonna take a lot of iteration. The way I do it is I essentially just go on the mic and I just give it a stream of consciousness of whatever I'm thinking for the video at large. Now you can have this something be totally original. This is coming straight out of your mind, or you can even give it, you know, scene descriptions or even dump a video of it that you're trying to template. Now, if you're actually going to give it a video that you want to essentially template yours off of, you'll have to use Gemini because something like Claude can't really handle the video, but really any AI can do this for you. And after you have this back and forth with AI, you want something that looks like this, a breakdown of your video. So you see mine has an act one, an act two, and an act three. And under each act, it has specific discrete shots, right? In this case, it started with, hey, that sort of like all those quick cuts at the beginning of the video. You remember that intro? Followed by, hey, some sort of like human action, have him taking a drink, and then he puts his goggles down. You'll notice here, the exact breakdown of the scenes is different than the final product. Totally normal. What you figure out in storyboarding probably will change along the way as you get to your final destination. And lastly, you can see it talking about the rabbit cuts with the action montage. The point of this is once I have this actually written down, I know the goal. I know what I'm doing. I'm not just jumping into an AI image editor and just throwing prompts at the wall and hoping something sticks and that it eventually becomes coherent. You need to have a 90% solution here before you move forward, because it will save you a ton of time, a ton of headache, and a ton of money. So get it looking something like this. Now we move on to step two, which is the foundation image, or in our case, the product image. Now, how do we create this and what tools are we using? My suggestion is you use Nano Banana Pro because it's the best one in the market today. In terms of how you create it prompt-wise, well, what we're gonna do is we're gonna lean on AI. Now what I did is I eventually just found some inspiration. I essentially modeled it off of the Prime energy drinks. So I just went to Claude. I dropped an example of a Prime energy drink. I very enthusiastically told Claude I want it in the style of a Prime energy drink like this one. And guess what? It wrote the prompt for me. I didn't have to come up with any of this myself. AI is really good at prompting if you kind of just like push it in the right direction. So I just took this prompt, went back to Nano Banana Pro, and you can see over here on the right, that's what I put in there. Now, you're probably asking yourself, this doesn't look like Nano Banana Pro to me. That's because I'm inside of InVideo. It's just a web app that essentially has like all of the AI generation tools on it. I think they're running some specials that give you like Nano Banana Pro free for a year if you sign up. It's just like an aggregator. You can use Nano Banana Pro wherever you want, whether that's Gemini or any other place. Now, a note on reference images. This is what my product looked like when I just used Claude prompt straight up. You'll notice it's pretty flat. I always suggest try to find something out there that's, you know, that you're trying to emulate. I mean, unless you're a designer on your own, chances are you're going to get something like this. I mean, not to say that this is necessarily like some industry leading design win, but I think it looks a bit better, right? It's based off something that's actually sold, so it can kind of help you move in the right direction. Of note, right, this is what I got originally, and I just made a few changes, right? I changed it from original to prompt punch, and then it also took me a few iterations to get there, right? You can see a few subtle differences. So you're going to have to make it, you know, make 4 or 5 different variations of your particular foundation image till you get what you want, but you need to get this perfect. And once you get something perfect, go ahead and make like color variations of it as well, especially if it's more like a food product or something. You can see that here, right? Different color schemes. The point is, you need to get here. You also want it if it's a product on something like a white background. That way, when you feed this to AI and you're really trying to make sure the product's consistent, it isn't essentially distracted by anything else from the reference image for the product. And once you have that, you're ready to move on to step 3. So now it's time to make the starting frame for each and every shot. Now this is where we head back to our storyboard. And if you've done all this perfectly, this will be extremely easy because all you have to do is you'll go to each individual shot, right? You have it in mind. You're then going to just give AI your foundation image, right? You can see that right here. I threw the foundation image. And then you're just gonna say, hey, let's create a text to image prompt where blah, 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 description of your first shot. And it's gonna give you the prompt, right? And if you nailed your storyboard and you knew exactly what you're trying to create, this should only take a couple prompts, maybe iterate it once or twice, and you're all done. But what does that look like in reality? That framework is exactly what you should do, but let me show you how it worked for me, because it'll probably be the same for you at the start. So this was the first result. I gave it the foundation image. I gave it the prompt Claude gave me, and it gave me this, right? Originally it was gonna be a guy opening the can, but in reality, it turned out ugly. Like, I didn't like this idea, not to mention this is all messed up, but I did like parts of it. I liked the lighting. I liked the general like feel of it. I liked the vibe. I just wanted to change the image itself. So first I just replayed the same prompt again. And you see that here, right? Maybe if I got a different angle, maybe a different generation with the same prompt, I'd get something I liked, but I didn't. I wanted to change it, but I wanted to keep the lighting. So what do you do then? Well, what you do is you take one of these images, you copy it, and you take the foundation image, remember the image of our product, you go to Nano Banana Pro, and you just use those as reference images to create something you like. In this case, I moved away from having the can being opened, and instead I just wanted the guy holding the can. That's what you see here. So I have the product. This is all correct. All the text is right, it's consistent. The lighting is the same as those first few shots. Even if I didn't like them, I wanted to keep those parts, and I got this. Now, even here, I was like, I don't know. I actually want the can in the ice. So what do you think I did here? Same exact process. I copied this image. I copied the foundation image, went back to Nano Banana Pro, and I said, hey, just put it in ice. And that's what we got here. And what you will also notice in these prompts, you see right here, these prompts are very, very simple. When I give it a reference image, like you see here, right? The one before where it's holding the can, it knows, Nano Banana Pro Smart, it understands like, hey, they gave it the reference images, they want me to change it, I'm going to keep the lighting the same, the aesthetics the same, the shadows the same, the text the same. You don't need to repeat yourself. All you need to give it is the changes you want. So that sort of workflow is how you need to essentially iterate on these starting frames, right? Just because you got an image you didn't necessarily like, if you liked parts of it, go ahead, use that as a reference image, use that to create something you actually want. Now, there's one more thing I need to talk about in this step when it comes to creating the starting images, and it is extremely important. What we just went over, this was the first frame of the first scene. So this first frame of the first scene where we're establishing the lighting and the vibes and the aesthetic, this is not only a first frame, this is sort of our quasi foundation image as well. So while I did create this original foundation image of our product, this also becomes sort of foundation image 1B in terms of the aesthetic. So moving forward, as I create all additional scenes, if it includes the product, I'm not only going to include this image, I'm also going to include this image as well. Furthermore, if I'm creating additional scenes and they don't include the product, I will still include this as a reference image so it knows what the scene should look like visually, right? Shadows, lighting, aesthetic, camera, all that. Now, as an example of what the heck I'm talking about this. This was a starting image for another scene down the line. Notice the prompt, right? AI gave me that prompt. I brought it to Claude, but I want you to pay attention to the attachment. You see that attachment down here? That attachment is this. Now, I put that there so it actually understands what I want the scene to look like visually. And you'll notice this image and this image, they have the same sort of like visual aesthetic, right? So that's what I'm talking about in terms of using these images to essentially leapfrog your way down the scenes to make sure everything's consistent. So you're just going to repeat that process over and over for each scene in your storyboard. You're going to go to AI, you're going to explain the scene, it's going to give you the prompt, you're going to go to Nano Banana Pro, you're going to include the appropriate reference images, and you're just going to go down the list, right? Just go down the list, knock them all out, and once you have that for each and every scene, you're ready to move forward. So now we're at step four, where we create the actual videos, and the process is relatively simple. So all you're going to do for each and every scene is you're going to take that starting image that you created, you're going to drop it into your video generator, and then you're going to include the prompt. Now, just like before in step three, we are going to be relying on AI for that video prompt. And a nice little trick you can do is when you ask AI to create those image prompts for you, you can simultaneously ask for a video prompt to go along with it. If you didn't do that already, what you can also do is you can go to AI's, you can dump in your starting frame, and then ask it for a video prompt to go along with that. And once it gives you the prompt, you paste it in and you generate it. Now, a few notes. First of all, what sort of video generator should we use? There's actually a lot of them on the market right now, and it's changing rapidly. As of today, you know, mid-December 2025, I think the best one lately is Kling Video 01. This one is great for a number of reasons. First of all, it does really good in terms of action sequences. And also, if you've watched some of my previous videos, I'll put a link above. Kling Video 01 also lets us edit videos. Now, the downside with Kling 01 is you don't get any audio, right? If you want audio, you need to look at either VO 3.1 Fast or Kling 2.6. But if you're not worried about the actual audio being generated natively in the video, I suggest using Kling 01. It's actually really, really good. Now, quick note on video creation. Remember, you are very rarely going to use the entire length of whatever is generated. Now, in my first draft of my ad, I actually included parts of this video, but if you watch it from beginning to end, you'll notice it has this crazy stuff at the beginning, right? Where she literally takes off the goggles and then another one comes down. But if I look at the clip strictly from, you know, here to here, right? It works just fine. So remember, when you're looking at these generations and there's some wonkiness to them, and honestly, you're seeing less of that in 01 versus VO 3.1, and this is 3.1 right here, that's still totally okay. You just need 1 to 2 seconds that actually works. And another technique I want to talk about is first frame, last frame. If we take a look at this video, right, how am I able to create a video if I'm only relying on the first frame, but the first frame of the scene isn't going to include my product, right? It's impossible to recreate that product from a text prompt only, but you probably are going to want to create some sort of dynamic scenes where like your product or your person shows up in the middle of it. So what are you supposed to do? Well, what you're going to do is you're going to create an end frame. Just like we can give these video generators that starting frame, right? In this case, an empty screen, I can also give them the final frame of that video, right? And if I zoom in, right, you can see I added both the starting frame and the end frame. And that end frame was this guy. So all I did is I went inside a Nano Banana Pro, I generated this image, I then generated an image without it, and then I went inside of Kling 01 and I gave it, hey, starting frame, end framed, and gave it the prompt. So always understand if you're trying to create, if you're trying to create scenes where stuff shows up in the middle, right, and you definitely know what you want the ending to look like, don't be afraid to do end frames as well as beginning frames. Beginning frames are just the baseline must have. End frames are just sort of like a more advanced technique that again gives you more control. And the rest of step four is just gonna continue along like that. Just like we did in step three where we went scene by scene with the images, now you're gonna go scene by scene creating the videos. Now you might see some of my shots, you know, and you're like, hey, like I would have never even thought to do like low angle stuff like this. I don't even know about these sort of angles in general. Well, in that case, I'm actually going to push you to another video I created, the link's above, where I go over camera control and angles, and also includes in a giant prompt library to help you come up with sort of the vocabulary to give AI to give you these sort of cinematic shots that otherwise you just don't know about. So you've created your videos for each scene. Now we can move on to our final step, which is production. Now, I'm no editing expert, but I'll kind of teach you some of the basics. I'm using CapCut. You can download CapCut for free. You're just going to dump all your videos into here, and then all you do is you drag and drop them into your timeline. At that point, all you really need to do is figure out what you want the order to be and how long you want each scene to be. When it comes to each scene and each shot, the shorter, the better. Okay. When it comes to AI video, it's getting really good, but the longer the video goes on for a single shot, the more likely some sort of like AI issue is going to pop up. So play to your strengths, keep the scenes short. Now note this cool little editing trick where it switches scenes. That was all done with AI using Kling 01. Check the video above. I'll link it for a quick tutorial how to do that. It's very easy. The other thing you want to think about, and oftentimes this will also play into when you change your shots, is the audio. For me, I actually just used AI-generated audio for this. I used 11 Labs. I'm on their $5 a month plan, but I'm pretty sure they'll generate audio for you, including the music, for free as well. But use whatever you want. And oftentimes you'll see that the shots change like on a specific beat. So that can also be something that can help structure your videos, because oftentimes it can be difficult if you're brand new to this to figure out what that structure should look like. But the editing doesn't need to be crazy. You've really done 99% of the work before you get here when it comes to the character consistency and the scene consistency. And you can really see that, right? As we move from character to character and scene to scene, even when the background changes, the lighting, sort of like the camera you would imagine all this was shot on, it's the same, right? And that's what we're going for. And most importantly, the product that we showcase throughout here is the same as well. Now, before we wrap this video up, as I promised in the beginning, I'm gonna show you a quick way to essentially recreate everything we did in this video automatically. It takes like three clicks. So InVideo has a tool called MoneyShot, and all you have to do is A, click on the tool, and I'll show you how to do that in a second. And then you just add reference images of your product, right? I gave four images of the can, like a few side views, the back and front are the same, as well as the top. You can do up to eight images. And then you just have it go to work and it creates a video like this.
Power find. Chase the moment. Chase the legend.
So it was able to create essentially a cinematic ad with this little prompt that I did no additional input with and a bare minimum of images, right? We could have gone way more in depth with more reference images. You can go more in depth with the prompt, but for four images and two clicks, right? Actually a really solid job. So to do that yourself inside of InVideo, all you do is you go down to trends, you go to MoneyShot, and then it has a bunch of different options here, right? You can see ones that are more action-based. You can see ones that's like are like studio. So there's a bunch of variations of that, but the point is the same. You just click it, you then include all of your reference images, and you can adjust the prompt as you want. So if everything we went through here was a little too complicated and you kind of wanted to almost get a proof of concept of how this could work with your product, this is a great way to do that. So this is where we're going to end it today. As always, let me know in the comments what you thought. Check out my Skool communities. There are tons of free resources there if you're into this sort of thing. And as always, I'll see you around.